Trump's State of the Union was last night, and it was awesome. Of course, that's a biased opinion because I'm a fan of Trump's. You know what aren't biased? Facts. You know who is biased? Fact checkers. But as usual, those so-called defenders of democracy have to insert themselves between Trump and your ears and insist you need them to tell you what is and is not fact. Let's look at some of the absolute worst fact-checking I have seen in a long time. Let's start with the New York Times. The U.S. economy is growing almost twice as fast today as when I took office, and we are considered far and away the hottest economy in the world. That's what Trump said. This is what the New York Times had to say in response. This is false. The American economy expanded at an annual rate of 3.5% in the third quarter of 2018. Growth in Latvia and Poland was almost twice as fast. Same for China and India. Even the troubled Greek economy posted stronger growth, and a wide range of economic analysts estimate that the growth of the American economy slowed in the fourth quarter and slowed even further in the first month of 2019. I almost don't even know where to start with this nonsense. Trump stated two things. The U.S. economy is growing twice as fast today as when he took office, and the U.S. has the hottest economy in the world. He did not compare our growth to the growth of other countries. It's simple, New York Times. You say the economy grew at 3.5% this year. When Trump took office, the economy was expanding at 1.8%. That's pretty damn close to double, as he said. You're really going to knock him for rounding 0.1%? As far as the laughable implication that Latvia and Poland are hotter economies because they had better growth, well, Latvia has an unemployment rate that is twice as high as the U.S. Poland's economy is a little over $1 trillion. The U.S.'s is almost $20 trillion. Now, doing some basic math, that means our economy grew $700 billion. Whereas Poland's economy, even though their growth was twice that of the U.S., grew by $84 billion. Gee, I wonder which economy Poland would rather have. Up next, we have created 5.3 million new jobs and importantly added 600,000 new manufacturing jobs, something which almost everyone said was impossible to do. But the fact is, we are just getting started. New York Times said this is false. The Bureau of Labor Statistics reports that since January 2017, when Mr. Trump took office, the economy has added 4.9 million jobs, including 454,000 jobs, manufacturing jobs. Far from being impossible, that is closely comparable to the pace of job creation during some two-year periods during the Obama administration, and significantly slower than the pace of job creation in manufacturing in the 1990s. First of all, are we really fact-checking 5.3 million compared to 4.9 million? Give me a break, New York Times. Trump seems to be including job creation from December of 2016 and January of 2017, which would indeed be 5.3 million. I'll admit, including December of 2016 is a bit misleading on Trump's part, but including January of 2017 isn't that much of a stretch. New York Times isn't including either number and explains the discrepancy between the two figures. As far as Trump's claim of it being impossible, he was clearly referring to creating manufacturing jobs, so comparing his job creation to Obama's job creation means absolutely nothing. Also, New York Times, why are you comparing manufacturing job creation under Trump to the 90s? Talk about misleading. Manufacturing jobs started to leave the U.S. at high rates starting in the early 2000s, and a lot of people, including Trump's predecessor Obama, said those jobs were not coming back. This is what Trump was referring to when he said it was impossible, as in it's impossible for those jobs to come back, and yet they are. He never once said manufacturing jobs under his presidency are growing at a faster rate than at any time in the past. More people are working now than at any time in our history. New York Times, this is misleading. While the total number of people working in the United States is higher than ever, it is not because of the president's policies. It is because more people than ever live in the United States. A 100% factual statement from beginning to end is considered misleading because Trump's policies aren't the reason more people are working than ever before, something Trump never claimed in the statement the New York Times quoted from him. What is this madness? If I had not been elected president of the United States, we would right now, in my opinion, be in a major war with North Korea. New York Times says there is no evidence. It's an opinion. Right there in the quote they have from Trump, he clearly states it's an opinion. Why is New York Times fact-checking an opinion? Here's a doozy from NPR. Trump said, and exactly one century after Congress passed the constitutional amendment giving women the right to vote, we also have more women serving in Congress than at any time before. NPR says, there are more women in Congress than ever before, but that is almost entirely because of Democrats, not Trump's party. Once again, we have a statement from Trump that is 100% true from beginning to end, but that's not good enough for NPR. Trump never once tried to take credit for all of the women in Congress, nor did he credit the Republican Party. He merely made a factual statement. This is like if I said the world is round, a simple fact everyone can agree on. Then NPR comes along and says, this isn't true. You are not responsible for the world being round. No shit, I never said I was. This so-called fact checker then goes on. The number of Republican women in the House has, in fact, fallen from 23 in the last Congress to 13 in this one. Talk about misleading. Let's look at those Republican women who are no longer in Congress. Ileana Ross Lehtinen. I probably butchered that, but she's from Florida. She decided not to run for re-election, and a Democrat woman won her seat. Karen Handel from Georgia lost her election to a Democrat woman. Lynn Jenkins from Kansas said in 2017 she was not going to run for re-election in 2019, so a Republican man ran instead and won. Kristi Noem from South Dakota went on to run for governor and won, becoming the first woman governor from that state. A male Republican ran for her old seat and won. Marsha Blackburn was a House member from Tennessee, but ran for the Senate and won, becoming the first woman senator from the state of Tennessee. A male Republican ran for her old seat and won. Diane Black, also from Tennessee, decided not to run for re-election for her House seat and decided to run for governor of the state, but lost. A male Republican ran for her old seat and won. Mia Love from Utah, the first Black woman Republican elected to Congress, lost her re-election to a male Democrat. Barbara Comstock from Virginia lost her re-election to a woman Democrat. This NPR fact checker makes it sound like the Republican Party is losing women politicians left and right, when in fact, 2 of the 10 women decided to run for higher offices and won, both making history in so doing. 4 of the 10 lost their re-elections to Democrats, one of which lost to a Democrat man, meaning not only did 3 of those Republican women lose their seats to Democrat women, which means the Democrat woman numbers rose in part because they ran against a fellow woman, but a Democrat man ran against a woman and won. And this somehow shows Republicans hate women? No male Republican ran against any of those 4 women. There is honestly so much garbage from these fact checkers that I can't possibly go over them all. Suffice to say, they are all largely full of shit. To be fair, some of them do back up what Trump says, but the vast majority of it is either nitpicking, like Trump saying 1 in 3 women are sexually assaulted on their journey to the U.S. illegally. Some sites have pointed out it's only 31%. Misleading, flat-out lying, or fact-checking an opinion. It's garbage.